Hi, Robert Kalechman here for Millennium. And today we discuss the invasion of the Peleliu Island, which occurred on the 15th of September, 1944, and lasted up until the 27th of November, 1944. It was one of the toughest campaigns in the South Pacific for the United States Marine Corps. The participants were the 1st Marine Division and the Japanese 14th Infantry Regiment. Now, these adversaries were more or less stationed on the island of Peleliu. But what Peleliu brought to the United States Marine Corps and to the General Staff of the United States of America was the fact that the defensive positions and the defensive tactics of the Imperial Japanese Army and Marines had changed. It had changed to where trying to destroy the invading force on the beachhead, the Japanese commander, what he had done was he had decided that he would let the invaders get onto the beach, and then as he drew them in, then he would release all his forces and would release havoc upon the United States Marines. Now, it should be noted that the 1st Marine Division, at the very end, due to the fact that they were so decimated, that they called in the 81st Division, the 81st Army Division, and they came in at the end and participated in the conquest of Peleliu. And the reason I bring it up is, number two, is one, it's factual, and secondly, I happen to have a very, very good friend of mine who was in that division, and every time we would speak, he would mention the fact that he took part in the invasion of Peleliu. He was an infantryman. His name was Leo Kaufman. He was in the advertising business in Hartford after he came out of the Marine Corps with his brother Lester. And he was a very, very fine gentleman, and he was a member of various various veterans organizations. Particularly, he was the driving force behind the Jewish American veterans in the Hartford County, Hartford area. And we remember Leo Kaufman. So on between the 15th and the 27th of November, when I think of this invasion and I think of Peleliu, certainly Leo Kaufman will cross my mind many times, along with the many Marines that participated. And I have to note that when you read the rosters, these fellas are unfortunately, they're leaving us. And there's not enough, in my opinion, being done for them. But this seems to be the attitude of the Veterans Administration towards their combat veterans. But let me get on with the facts and figures on the invasion of Peleliu by the 1st Marine Division. The combatants, belligerents, you might say, were William H. Rupus. He was the commanding general of the 1st Marine Division. And the Japanese commander was Kogo Nagagaga. And his subordinate Japanese commander was Seida Inoue, and the subordinate to General Rufus was Paul J. Muller and Roy S. Geiger. General Geiger later became the commanding general for the invasion of Okinawa, when the army general was killed in action, and Roy Geiger, General Geiger, took over for him. And let me mention, General Geiger is well remembered in Marine Corps history. He has a camp in Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, named after him, called Camp Geiger. And he's remembered by most Marines. The General Rupus, and I want to mention his name in the sense that he brought quite a history and quite a pride, and put pride in the United States Marine Corps, especially the 1st Marine Division. And in the early, the late 1941, early 1942, he sat and wrote what is known as the Marine Corps Rifleman's Creed. And I'm going to read that to you in the sense that I want you to know that during the training of these Marines that were preparing to go into the South Pacific was quite a feat. And he instilled the fierceness and the loyalty and the brotherhood in these Marines. And he more or less instilled self-confidence in them. And this is the poem that every Marine more or less memorizes when he goes into training. And the name of it is The Rifleman's Creed. And it was written by Major General William H. Rupus. He wrote it during World War II, the early part, or the latter part of 1941, and the early part of 42. And this is the original text. And it starts, "This is my rifle. There are many like it, but this one is mine. My rifle is my best friend. It's my life. I must master it as I master my life. My rifle without me is useless. Without my rifle, I am useless. I must fire my rifle true. I must shoot straighter than my enemy who is trying to kill me. I must shoot before he shoots me. I will. My rifle and I know that what counts in war is not the rounds we fire, the noise of our burst, nor the smoke we make. We know that it's the hits that count. We will hit. My rifle is human, even as I, because it is my life. Thus I will learn it as a brother. I will learn it, its weaknesses, its strengths, its parts, its accessories, its sight and its barrel. I will keep my rifle clean and ready, even as I am clean and ready. We will become part of each other. We will. Before God, I swear this creed. My rifle and I are defenders of my country. We are the masters of our enemy. We are the saviors of my life. So be it, until victory is America's and there is no enemy but peace." And this is the ability of General Rupus. And it's just to point out that a lot of these men were very, very educated, dedicated, and we certainly can use a few more just like General Rupus at this point in our country's history. And we go on to the enemy force, and the American forces. We had a situation where the American strength was 47,561. Those were the total American forces. The enemy strength, the Imperial Japanese Army, was 13,600. Casualties and losses. The 1st Marine Division, 1,300 killed, 5,450 wounded, 36 missing. And missing is they never found the remains. Japanese forces, out of the 13,600, which included, in my opinion, Korean laborers and Okinawan laborers that were part of the enemy force. And it has to be noted at this point that in most cases, all the Korean laborers were slave labor, forced labor. They had no choice whatsoever. They came down the road, and when the Japanese decided they wanted laborers, whether men or women, they would pick them up and take them to Japan, and they would go to be assigned to an island or in the islands of Japan, whether it was the island of Honshu, the island of Hokkaido, or the island of Kyushu. Those were the three main islands that they would be assigned to. And in many cases, a lot of these Japanese forces, unlike the American forces, excluding the State Guard and the National Guards, a lot of these forces in Japan, they were all made up of the town or the particular country. Like a lot of the 14th Army, they came from the island of Hokkaido. And a lot of the uniforms were Hokkaido being a northern island, they would be wool uniforms that they would wear in the South Pacific. So they were, and their casualties were 10,900 killed, and of the all Japanese force, out of 13,600, this is a figure, out of 13,600, captured were 202. Let's think about that ratio. The Marines couldn't take them, or in most cases they didn't trust them and wouldn't take them. So that was the situation there. And as that went on, one of the main battles, but before I go into that, what I'd like to do is discuss a situation that was prevalent in the Marine Corps in the 40s and early 40s, not 41. Was what they called the old breed. These were Marines, we called them the old breed, and the reason they were called the old breed were they were the old timers. They were the fellows that were dedicated to the Marine Corps, had been in the Marine Corps a while, and taught people, or taught Marines, how to be Marines. And there's a few still with us, but not very many. And I would call the old breed were men like this gentleman. And they were the visionaries of the Marine Corps. And this general here, this is General Mad Dog Smith, Holland Mad Dog Smith. And he was the old breed. And he was a leader of the old breed. And these were dedicated Marines. These were Marines that would teach these younger men that came in how to be Marines. And what they taught was how to be very, very diligent, how to be very aggressive when the time occurred, and not to talk about it, but to do it. And these were the type of leaders we had. And among one of the others that I might mention at this time was, at the time, was General Chesty Puller, who at the time of this invasion was the regimental commander of the 1st Marine Regiment, 1st Marine Division, which we will discuss, The 1st Marine Division, and I'm going to have him put up a picture, a photo of the 1st Marine Division, what they called the shoulder patch. And it was a one on a blue field, when and inside the letter one was the words Guadalcanal. And if you notice the stars, you won't see this. If you look into the sky today and you look at the sky at night, you won't see these stars. These stars are from the Southern Pacific. This is this setup of stars, five stars here, this is called the Southern Cross. And it's fun. You can look up in the sky in Australia, New Zealand, South Pacific, you'll see the Southern Cross. But you won't see it in the Northern Hemisphere, our hemisphere. And that was the shoulder patch that they decided to use. And the 2nd Marine Division has a similar patch, but it has a two in it, and it also has the Southern Cross. And that resembles, because these two divisions spent a great deal of time in the South Pacific. And in my opinion, they turned around an offensive program by the United States Armed Forces into a defensive program into an offensive program, and put the Japanese Army and Navy on the defensive, where up until the Marines were introduced, they were more or less on the offensive, and there wasn't an army that could stop them. The United States Marine Corps stopped them. And I just want to more or less give you an idea. The 1st Marine Division is an infantry division. Its role is amphibious assaults. And the size usually runs between 25,000 and 30,000, including what we call force troops, which is artillery, large artillery. In the 1st Marine Division, their base camp was Camp Pendleton, which is located in California. It's between San Diego and Los Angeles. And if you're ever on that, in that area, and you take a ride, you rent a car and go from Los Angeles to San Diego or vice versa, you'll find that as you drive through, you'll drive through Camp Pendleton. And they were an expeditionary force, they were. And they were called the Old Breed. It was because of the old timers. And they truly, they weren't old, but they had been in the Corps a while, and they were very, very diligent and combat wise. And the motto of the 1st Marine Division, and Sinsbury ought to take this to heart, and a lot of the selectmen and politicians that are running around and doing everything, including their whole more or less modus operandi is lip service, but they should adopt this this motto: no better friend, no worst enemy. And the march that they have is waltzing Matilda, and I imagine, I don't know, but I imagine the reason for this is that the 1st Marine Division, when they were pulled out of Guadalcanal, they spent a lot of time down in Australia and New Zealand, and one of the tunes that the Australians and New Zealanders sing is Waltzing Matilda. That's quite a touchy tune. But that's the march of the United States Marine Corps. And in World War I, they, in this going back to the Sergeant Major Daniel Daly's days, they had the Alsace Defensive, the Battle of Belle Woods, which you all know, the Battle of Chateau Terry, the Battle of San Miguel, the Battle of Blancmont Ridge, and the Argonne Forest Offensive. World War II, their battle streamers consist of Guadalcanal, Cape Gloucester, Peleliu, and Okinawa. And I had known Marines that when they finished the Battle of Okinawa, or when they went from Peleliu into Okinawa, many of them had malaria. And they participated in the invasion of malaria, in the invasion of Okinawa with malaria. And the gall and the drive, they participated. They wouldn't leave their comrades. And after the island of Okinawa was captured and things got back to normal, a lot of these fellows went to hospitals, or a lot of them had attacks on the ships, and they had to be taken wherever they ended up, because a lot of the, after the Battle of Okinawa and Japan was settled down, a lot of the 1st Marine Division went into China, and they occupied China, and they disarmed the Japanese in China for the Chinese people. And a lot of them went into Shanghai. A lot of them went back into Taizing. A lot of them went to the city of Beijing. And those were the towns that they occupied, and of course they retook the enemy. And there's a cute story that one of the that's told about an officer of the Marine Corps, 1st Division, when he went into more or less China. And they were disarming these Japanese, and they went to the Marine Corps barracks, which had belonged to Marines, and the Japanese had occupied during World War II. He went to them, and when the Japanese commander came to him, he said, "What am I going to do with my men?" He said, "I don't care what you do with your men," he says, "but you better get them out of here in 24 hours, or I'm going to do something to your men." And there was no love between the Japanese and the 1st Marine Division. Let me assure you of that. Now, I've more or less allotted my time, but I would be remiss if I didn't more or less go into the honor the men that did were given recognition for their valor and for their supreme sacrifice. There were 8 Marines who received the Medal of Honor on the Battle of Peleliu. They were Corporal Bessel, Private First Class Jackson, Private First Class Krause, Private First Class New, Private First Class Phelps, Captain Everett P. Pope, Private First Class Roan, and First Lieutenant Carl R. Roth, 1st Battalion, 5th Marines. These were the Marines that were given the Medal of Honor and made the supreme sacrifice for all of us today. Now, I just want to more or less change hats and give you citizens of Simsbury and voters and remind you of the election coming up. Please vote. And the town budget is put together with smoke and mirrors. And the budget was cut by the first selectman. But where did she cut? She cut the police, the public safety division. Now, the Democratic state representative, John Hampton, who's running for state representative, has taken over $1,000 in public funds for his election. This is public money that he takes that can be used to lower your taxes and lower town taxes. But the tax and spend your dollar is what Democrats do best. For change, let's debate and stop hiding from the issues and misleading the voters of Simsbury's 16th district. Let's get out there. I think it's time for a change. The two federal senators who belong to the Do Nothing Party, also Democrats, watch as people and Christians are murdered in Iraq and Syria, and Americans are beheaded by IFIL, while the Connecticut Congress, all Democrats, sit on their hands and run from the issue. Sad but true. We have 7 Democratic representatives from Connecticut who represent Connecticut in the United States Congress. I haven't heard one come out and speak against the deplorable, barbaric acts that are occurring in Syria and Iraq, northern Iraq, up around Mosul. Are you aware that Mosul, that's the old Nineveh in the Bible? And something has to be done there. And we as Americans, we can't sit by and let it happen. We can't let Christians be murdered. We can't let Americans be beheaded. We have to act. And we have to act very severely. And we have to more or less annihilate the people of ISIL, ISIS, IFIL. And that's the thought I'd like to leave you with. Contact your congressman and senator and insist that they stop the murdering and beheading in Syria and Iraq. And I'm making this motion or that motion. That's what they're good at best, is talk. We don't need any happy talk. What we need is decisive action. Thank you for letting me come into your homes, and God bless.
Funding for Simsbury Community Television is provided in part by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.